Hi, I'm Voltaire Tupas. Welcome to Rappler Talk. At the height of the Rohingya migration crisis, the Human Rights Watch accuses the ASEAN member states of subjecting close to 8,000 boat people who have suffered months-long starvation and distress to a game of human ping pong. Joining us today is Philem Kain, Human Rights Watch Deputy Director for Asia, to discuss the issue further, including another controversial human rights issue in the Philippines, summary killings in Davao City. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Kain, let me take you back to the point of origin of the issue as far as the Rohingya people are concerned. Who is accountable exactly? What is the accountability of Myanmar, the region, and the international community?
There's a two-prong approach to this. And right now we're dealing with a regional humanitarian crisis. Mm-hmm. So it requires a regional humanitarian response. So that means those frontline states where these boatloads of Rohingya boat people, Bangladeshi migrants are washing up, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, they need to launch an urgent search and rescue operation. They need to identify where those boats are and take immediate action to find them and to bring them in. Why? Because these boats are literally floating coffins unless those people get to shore soon. They've been at sea for weeks or months without enough food and water, and they need help now.
You are stressing the urgency of the issue. It's a crisis, apparently. Can your organization, because you've been monitoring the issue for months, what's the exact condition at sea and even back in Myanmar?
So we know that there are an estimated up to 8,000 people still at sea in boats of questionable seaworthiness with inadequate supplies of water and food, being exposed to the elements. So men, women, and children who are sick in extreme conditions. And to a large extent, you know, they've been abandoned by these human smugglers. And so they are floating on the ocean, often lost and adrift, and they need to be located by naval forces of these three frontline states, Indonesia, Malaysia, and Thailand, and brought back to shore. Now, why have these people taken to the seas? That refers to your question about what's going on in Myanmar. You know, the Rohingya in Myanmar, living in Western Arakan State, over the last 3 years, Human Rights Watch has documented a pattern of appalling abuses against this ethnic Muslim minority, essentially ethnic cleansing by extremely racist Buddhist Rakhine Arakan State groups and individuals. And so we have about 150,000 Rohingya who are confined to these squalid internally displaced people's camps with inadequate supplies of food, medicine, no access to livelihood or education for their children, who are essentially choosing to flee Myanmar, to flee Burma, because the conditions at home are so terrible that they're willing to risk death at sea rather than stay in this, essentially, this prison camp of their home state of Arakan.
Not to mention they are denied of their identity as a people. Can you elaborate more on their plight as a people as far as their identity is concerned?
So the Rohingya in Burma have long been marginalized community. In recent years, that has intensified. And essentially, these are stateless people. The Burmese government refuses to recognize their identity as Burmese citizens. They refer to them as Bengalis. And they absolutely take no responsibility for their plight, and they take no steps to protect them from these often violent and sometimes even deadly attacks upon them inside Arakan State. So this has essentially reached a boiling point where this community of Rohingya are seeking to flee rather than stay and endure these increasingly dire conditions at home.
As you've said, they're described often as stateless people. What exactly does that mean as far as these migrants are concerned, and what internationally governs their case?
So these people, according to the Burmese government, refuses to recognize them as Burmese citizens, refers to them as Bengalis. So therefore, they are denied the benefits of citizenship within Burma. Even in the most recent census, they refuse to count these individuals as what they identify themselves as Rohingya. This situation has even got to the point where we have seen the passage within in the recent day or two of a new law on family planning that essentially imposes birth spacing on the Rohingya Rohingya minority, which seems to be designed to limit their population. So this is a form of really scary eugenics by the Burmese government against its beleaguered ethnic Muslim minority, the Rohingya.
What does it say about Myanmar? At this point, the perception, as far as the international community is concerned, they have, to a certain extent, adapted democratic principles. In fact, they have resumed ties with the U.S. And then I understand there are support is coming from Japan, from the European Union. What's the role of the West in this particular crisis? How can they help?
Yeah, so there's this lingering narrative about the new Burma. In recent years, Burma has made a transition from an extremely oppressive authoritarian state toward a more democratic style of government. But at the same time, we have seen that this Burmese government, even though it no longer identifies itself as authoritarian, is pursuing and intensifying extremely discriminatory policies against its ethnic Muslim Rohingya minority. This is occurring at a time when the European Union, the United States, Japan are increasing and widening and deepening their engagement with the Burmese government, and coming with that is huge influxes of donor funding, and so to a large extent, these major donors, these funders, these international partners of Burma have refused to speak up and to speak out on behalf of this besieged ethnic Muslim minority, the Rohingya. So part of the responsibility for what we're seeing now lies with supporters and allies and bilateral partners of the Burmese government, because they have not taken action to speak out and defend the Rohingya.
How exactly should they intervene?
These are, so Japan, the EU, the United States, these are states that have forged close ties with this new government of Burma, that have committed large amounts of donor funding for the Burmese government, for development projects within within Burma. So they have leverage in terms of how they spend their money, and they have leverage in signaling to the Burmese government that there is not an inexhaustible blank check for a government which refuses to respect the universal rights and freedoms of a minority people such as the Rohingya. That continuing attacks and marginalization and literal ethnic cleansing of the Rohingya won't be tolerated, and that there will be a price to pay in terms of bilateral ties between Burma and the US and the EU and Japan.
Why are they taking a relatively soft stance on this?
You know, it's a mystery. It's not for a lack of documented evidence of abuses. You know, in 2012, Human Rights Watch published a report documenting how in Sitwe, in Arakan State, how there was ethnic cleansing and violence and killings of the Rohingya people in that area. So over the last 3 years, there's been more than enough evidence of the worsening conditions. But for some reason, you know, these governments have refused to put the pressure on the Burmese government to stop these abusive policies. And as a result, they get away with it and they keep doing it.
And as far as Aung San Suu Kyi is concerned, she's been silent all this time. In your view, do you think she should be more strong in her position?
You know, all politicians, all people of conscience within Burma with any type of public platform should be speaking out loudly, clearly, and directly that the Burmese government's abuse of the ethnic minority, the Rohingya, cannot be tolerated. So, you know, we urge Aung San Suu Kyi, we urge all of the politicians in Burma to see that there should be an end to this abuse and to pursue a course to make sure that the rights of the ethnic Muslim minority, the Rohingya, are protected inside Myanmar.
Let's zoom out to the region.
Sure.
The region, because we're trying to integrate the region into the ASEAN community.
Yeah.
What role can it take? Apparently, it tries to listen to the wishes of Myanmar not to intervene. But what exactly can it do as a community?
Well, I think first is that, you know, we this crisis and the fact that this crisis has been able to continue for such a long period of time really highlights the scandalously negligent approach of ASEAN toward the human rights abuses of its members. Now, this is not a new story. ASEAN has long taken an official blind eye toward the human rights abuses of its members. But here we have a situation in which the Burmese government's abuse of an ethnic minority within its borders has created conditions so dire within the country that it's resulted in this outflow of desperate refugees, asylum seekers, which have created huge problems for its neighbors. So the Burmese government's abuse of human rights at home have created a regional humanitarian crisis, which it refuses to take adequate responsibility for. At the same time, we don't see ASEAN speaking with one voice, strongly urging and taking steps to bring in and rein in this member of ASEAN, which is trampling on the universal rights and freedoms of its ethnic Rohingya minority.
And it can strategically evolve into a crisis in the future as far as migration is concerned.
Okay.
So it has a human rights desk, I understand. Are you saying that it's not working at this point? What should it do to improve their mechanism in terms of responding to migration issues like this?
Essentially, any human rights mechanism that is going to actually have any type of effect has to have teeth, which means that for any grouping, if a member state, and in this case ASEAN, is violating the universal rights and freedoms of its members and creating this regional humanitarian crisis, there should be a mechanism by which ASEAN can leverage and pressure the respective government, in this case Burma, to stop those abuses. Mm-hmm. And the fact is we see no type of attempted leverage. We see no type of mechanism with actual teeth to enforce better behavior, because that's what's required: better behavior, respect of the rights and freedoms of the Rohingya within Burma.
Last week, at least three countries, Thailand, Indonesia, and Malaysia have seemingly softened their position on the issue, and in fact accommodated some of the refugees.
Mm-hmm.
Is this a positive development, considering that it's tactical, they're just going to provide temporary shelter?
The news that last week that the governments of Malaysia, Thailand, and Indonesia were going to stop their unacceptable stance of not helping the Rohingya boat people, this was a good sign. This was a good signal. However, like I said earlier, what's needed from these states is a much more proactive response. This is a humanitarian emergency that requires search and rescue by those states to actively identify, find, and bring in those boats. Otherwise, people are going to die. Also, there is a difference in terms of how these states are responding. It's worth noting that Thailand is still classifying the Rohingya who come ashore as illegal migrants and putting them into immigration detention lockup as if they are criminals or felons. That's unacceptable. So what we need to see is we need to see more active efforts to bring in those boats, to save those people's lives, give them unimpeded access to the United Nations High Commission for Refugees in order for that agency to sort out who is who. Are they from Burma? Are they from Bangladesh? Are they asylum seekers? Are they economic migrants? And then begin the process of either repatriating them, relocating them, solving this problem.
Strategically, what's the ideal situation for the people, for the refugees? Should they be resettled? Where and how?
This is a question that the United Nations High Commission for Refugees has the expertise to determine and to resolve. And so it requires them to have immediate and unimpeded access. But in the longer term, of course, it's going to require friendly states to accept the relocation of people who are identified as refugees or asylum seekers. It's also going to require states, the frontline states like Indonesia, like Thailand, like Malaysia, to accept a certain number of these people to live and work in these countries. I think that we need to be realistic that it's not going to be possible to, in a short period of time, to relocate to these people to new countries in a short period of time.
The Philippines, it was sympathetic to the plight of the Rohingyas. Mm-hmm. Did it make a dent at all?
You know, the Philippines deserves praise because it's led by example here. You know, they identified the problem and said, we will assist these boat refugees in whatever way possible. That's the first thing. The second thing is they came out and said, we will help to take in up to 3,000 of these boat people in order to assist them in their relocation or repatriation. You know, the Philippines has also come out and said it's going to attend this regional meeting on May 29th in Thailand to help to try to find a longer term solution to this. So in terms of rhetoric, the Philippines is saying all the right things, and it really should be a model for how other states respond.
Let me shift to the local context.
Sure.
In the Philippines, we're also facing other human rights issues.
Sure.
And your organization is focusing on the case of the death squads in Davao. Today, this morning, I think the mayor of Davao, Mayor Duterte, challenged the Human Rights Watch to file cases in court, and he dared you to do that, and he'll show you how silly or quote unquote stupid you are. Well, how do you react to that strong words?
You know, extrajudicial killings are a serious problem in the Philippines. It's a human rights issue that Human Rights Watch has devoted significant research on over a long period of years in multiple locations. That's the first thing. The second thing is that the problem of extrajudicial killings has been recognized by Human Rights Watch, by the United Nations, and by the Philippines government itself. So our concerns are that that Mayor Duterte has continued to assert that extrajudicial killings are a prescription for solving crime problems, which is an absolute an attempted defense of the indefensible. And our position is that Mayor Duterte has repeatedly and vividly reiterated the justification for the Ombudsman's office to launch an investigation into his alleged links to Davao death squads.
What do you say to his comment saying that human rights groups are hypocrites, including your group for pursuing this? In fact, you can't even address the human rights issues in your own backyard in other countries.
Yeah.
What's your reaction?
You know, Mayor Duterte's statements are something that should be of great interest to the Ombudsman, to the Philippines police, because he is apparently attempting to claim responsibility for a death squad activity that has claimed the lives of many Filipinos. So I think that the key issue here is that the appropriate authorities are given time to speak with Mayor Duterte and allow him to share his thoughts about his alleged responsibility in these deaths. I think that should be the priority.
Yeah. You said in your statement that there's a culture of tolerance from lawmakers for Duterte. Why do you say? Are you saying that Filipino politicians are condoning the acts of Duterte, even the government?
I think it's worth noting that in 2012, the Commission for Human Rights recommended to the Office of the Ombudsman that Mayor Duterte be investigated for his alleged links to death squad killings in Davao. Now, the Ombudsman's office did not do so. And there has not been any type of high-profile challenge to Mayor Duterte's statements over the years, of which there have been many, in support of extrajudicial killings. So I think it's fair to say, if you look at the record, that there has been and continues to be a tolerance and a blind eye to the extremely objectionable statements that Mayor Duterte makes about killing people without any type of due legal process.
What statement would you like to hear from the Aquino government as far as the death squads in Mindanao? is concerned.
The Aquino government really needs to state loud and clear, reiterate that extrajudicial killings are a serious issue in the Philippines, and one that the government intends to confront head on. And by and part of that is it will not accept any publicly elected official to express support for such absolutely unacceptable abusive methods of quote unquote crime control. So there needs to be a loud and clear message that the type, that the style of governance of people like Mayor Duterte have no place in a modern democratic society like the Philippines.
But unfortunately, that's not how the public is viewing that. In fact, locally, he is feared, and people feel that his methods are effective because of the crime rate. And across the country, he's now touring, he's campaigning, and he placed third in the recent survey, the presidential survey. What do you say about the culture in the Philippines as far as the appreciation of the people on human rights?
Yeah, a year ago, Human Rights Watch released a report about death squad killings in Tagum City. And that report showed that a death squad that was organized by former Mayor Ray Uy killed hundreds of people and then morphed into a freelance kill-for-hire operation that had absolutely no control, that absolutely took no orders from anyone except the killers themselves. My message is this, is that, you know, giving a green light or public credit to a death squad operation is probably one of the most dangerous things that a society can do. And the Philippines deserves better. The Philippines is a society that has transformed from authoritarian dictatorship to a rule of law, rights-respecting country. And to allow death squads to operate openly and be praised by public officials is an absolute wrong step in the wrong direction.
But in general, how do you assess the human rights situation in the country? We have experienced the worst under the previous administration, and you've also noted about the impunity at that time, and you're saying it has persisted. At this point, do you see any development, at least from other fronts?
Yeah, look, there's always room for improvement. And the fact is that, as you say, the Philippines has made this transformation from this brutal authoritarian dictatorship that it suffered under for many decades. There are issues that the Philippines government needs to pay greater attention to. There needs to be a greater attention to addressing this culture of impunity here. This, you know, allowing extrajudicial killings to continue, allowing their killers to escape, allowing the people who praise the killers to make pronunciations in support of extrajudicial killings. You know, these are things that are easily addressed. It requires political will to say this is wrong and we do things differently by rule of law here.
Thank you for joining us and for sharing your views. We've been talking to Human Rights Watch Deputy Director for Asia, Philip Kain, about the Rohingya migration crisis and the summary killings in Davao City. I'm Voltaire Tupas. Thank you for watching.